extortion. Extortion, strong arm tactics, pay me something or else. It's the ultimate in trick-or-treating. Well, one best-selling author says it goes on in the halls of Congress every day. And of course, because they're doing it, it's legal. Here's Paul Strand from Washington.
When you think about what's broken about Washington, you may think about the endless arguments, along with influence peddling and buying votes. You may also think those to blame for it are the outside special interest, or the fat cat lobbyists, big oil, big pharma, the NRA, the AARP. But when it comes to profiting from their positions, subsidizing lavish lifestyles, and skirting the rules to do it, you can also blame members of Congress themselves. In his new book, Extortion, How Politicians Extract Your Money, Buy Votes, and Line Their Own Pockets, author Peter Schweizer tells the shocking truth about how members of Congress on both sides of the aisle have been creating their own secret private slush funds. And how do they pay for them? Schweizer says they do it by shaking down entire industries, by forcing them to pay up by threatening to pass laws that could hurt them, or not pass laws that could help them. Schweizer says members of Congress, both Republican and Democrat, routinely engage in a form of legal extortion that would get the rest of us thrown in prison.
Well, Peter Schweizer is here with us now from Washington. Peter, extortion is a strong word. How do these guys get away with what you're talking about?
Well, it's a classic case, Pat, of they get to write the rules, and so they write the rules in such a way that it doesn't apply to them. You know, and the example I often use from real day life is we had a problem in urban America 20 years ago, Pat, where somebody would come up to you at a stoplight to your car, and they'd have a brick in one hand and a cloth in the other, and they'd say, I'm going to wash your window. And everybody knew you had to pay them, because if you didn't, that brick would go through your windshield. That was extortion. That was dealt with. It's something very similar that happens in Washington, D.C. It's just that they're wearing suits rather than street clothes.
You pointed out something that I think is particularly iniquitous, and that is the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. Nobody understands what the rules are, how the game is played, but you said they're doing it masterfully to extort money. Would you elaborate on that?
Yeah, it really began with the Obama administration in 2009. The Foreign Corrupt Practices Act is a very vaguely written law that says if you give something of value, not really defined, to a foreign government official in exchange for business, you can be thrown into jail, as can your shareholders and members of your corporate board. The problem is that law is open to wide interpretation. So you went from, on average, for 30 years, about two or three prosecutions a year between Democrat and Republican administrations, to under President Obama having more than 150 investigations in 2009, many of them politically directed against industries or individual companies that weren't totally supportive of his agenda. So it was a form of extortion, but it's also a form of intimidation used against political opponents.
Wait just a minute. You mean if you're giving money to Obama, supporting his campaign, the feds leave you alone? If you're not, I mean, the other way around, if you're not giving to him, they come after you? Is that what you're saying?
Yes, and in fact, there are academic studies I cite in the book. These are not done by, you know, conservatives. These are done by academic scholars. And what those studies show, Pat, is that if you give campaign donations and hire the right lobbyists, you dramatically reduce the chance that you are going to be subject to an investigation by the SEC, or the penalties that you are going to face are going to be dramatically less. So it's a classic example of justice for sale. And we have the Department of Justice in this administration in particular using the tool of the law to intimidate political opponents and to enrich themselves or affiliated lawyers.
This is so horrible, but you think of the majority leader of the United States Senate, a guy from a very small state of Nevada. You had some pretty damning things to say about Harry Reid. Do you want to elaborate on that?
Yeah, well, I mean, Harry Reid and his family, as far as I'm concerned, and I think the evidence is overwhelming, have operated like a organized crime family. I mean, if you want to get anything done in Nevada, you've got to go through Harry Reid's family. He's got three sons and a son-in-law, all of whom have been registered lobbyists or government affair consultants of one form or another. And Harry Reid's staff has been very open and on the record in saying that his basic methodology is to intimidate people. people, that intimidation is how he gets things done. So you don't want to make an enemy of Harry Reid if you're in Nevada. And if you need to get something done, you've got to go through him, which to me is a terrible state for our politics to be in this country.
He comes through as a benign old uncle. doesn't he? I mean, really, that's his image.
Yeah.
But you say not true.
Yeah, no, that's exactly right. And we sort of chart the history of his rise to prominence in Nevada politics. And he came through the Nevada Gaming Commission, where he did a lot of dealing with organized crime. He helped get some people sent to jail. But he was also very open in saying, look, a lot of these people are my friends and remain my friends. I'm not saying that he is part of organized crime per se, but it's very clear that the methods that they use and the tools that they use, not physical violence per se, but threats of, say, financial violence against people are the sort of tools that he used. And they're very creative in sort of moving money around through various committees. When his son ran for governor in 2010, Pat, they set up more than 900 political action committees that would allow a donor to donate to all of these committees, and then the money would be consolidated back on the other side. It was a way of getting around campaign finance laws. That's the sort of thing we're talking about here.
Well, you're also talking about people having campaign committees that get big amounts of money, then they siphon funds from the campaign committee to their own pockets. How does that work?
Yeah, you know, when we think of a campaign committee, we think of, you know, friends of Peter Schweizer, you're running for Congress. And that regular campaign committee like that has lots of restrictions on it. The FEC says, I can't take that campaign money and take the family to Disney World. That's breaking the law and you'll go to jail. And in fact, that's what happened to Jesse Jackson Jr. Recently, and it's happened to others. But they've set up these vehicles called leadership PACs, leadership political action committees. And the FEC has no restrictions on how you can use that money. So literally, Pat, you have members of Congress who are taking their family on trips overseas. They're going and playing at the top golf resorts around the world. They're staying at five-star resorts. They're hiring limousines. You name it. And so what it means is that this political fundraising is no longer just about winning election or re-election. It's a lifestyle subsidy. It allows them to live large, as it were.
You've documented this. There's no question. You have documental proof of these things?
Absolutely. This is all drawn from FEC records, Federal Election Commission records, and we had just recently a story on 60 Minutes, which was a joint investigation, and it featured this. And the other thing they do, Pat, is literally members of Congress will take their own personal money and loan it to their campaigns, but they will charge the campaign exorbitant rates of interest, say 18% interest a year. We had one congresswoman from California who charged 18% a year and took more than 20 years to pay off the loan. So you can see where this is leading. It's a very creative way to walk away with hundreds of thousands of dollars that is just being siphoned off from your campaign.
You were an equal opportunity assassin on this when you talked about Roy Blunt and Missouri. What about him?
Well, you know, it's similar to what you see with Harry Reid. And, you know, my view on this, Pat, is that we've got big problems in this country. I certainly am politically conservative, but I also view that human nature is a constant. And if you give people the opportunity to get away with something, they're going to try to do that. So we're talking about a systematic problem. And what you have in the case of Roy Blunt in Missouri or Harry Reid in Nevada, these are both instances where the families are completely engaged in an enterprise of collecting money based on political power. Both of them have multiple family members who are lobbyists. They make a lot of money because the head of those families are in elected political positions.
You had an expose of the fact that congressmen were trading on insider information, and your expose actually got the law changed, didn't it?
It did. Certainly not a perfect law. It was called the Stock Act. And actually, you know, 700 Club was a great help on this. So we did a feature, a story on this, and it really helped propel this law forward. It's called the Stock Act. And what it basically does is it says now that insider trading by members of Congress is now a crime, as it is for the rest of us. The problem, though, is that the law has kind of been watered down, and they're really expecting the Securities and Exchange Commission to enforce this. Congress to threaten to go after, say, a powerful member of Congress. The problem, of course, Pat, is that Congress sets the budget and the Senate confirms who sits on the SEC. So I'm very doubtful that they're actually going to go after these individuals. I think we need to have elected officials put their assets in blind trusts so we don't even have to worry about the fact that insider trading is taking place.
Peter, one last question. You've raised some very important things in this book, Extortion, which I think people ought to get and read. It's a shocking expose, backed up by tremendous research. What is the corrective on this one? Is there any law that could be passed or just throw the bums out and get some honest ones in there or what?
Well, I think that's a sentiment a lot of people have. I've proposed several reforms. One of them, Pat, is to do in Washington, D.C., what we're already doing in 27 states with state legislatures in Florida, Texas, Washington State. And in those states, they have a very simple law. It says that when the legislature is meeting, members of the legislature cannot solicit or receive campaign contributions, period. Now, if we did that in Washington, D.C., it would be an earthquake, but I think it'd do two things. Number one, it would force them to make better use of their time, because if for no other reason, they want to be back raising money. But I think the second thing it would do is it would get rid of this sort of ability to kind of leverage. It would not allow them to, you know, go up to the car, as we were talking about earlier, with a sponge in one hand and a brick in the other, because you don't have the immediacy of a legislative threat by which they can leverage companies and industries to give them donations. So that's just one of the reforms I propose.
Well, I hope some of them are put into effect, but this is a shocking thing. And, you know, you want to have trust in your president, but he lies to you. You want to have a trust in the Congress, but they're fattening their own coffers. There are a few really, really honest, honorable ones, but it's a shame that there are not more of them.
Who's got Peter's back on this?
Well, I don't know, Peter. Are you safe at night, man?
Well, I think we're getting a lot of attention, like on this program and others, so that's always helpful to be out there publicly so everybody sees what we're researching and what's going on. But I appreciate your concern, and I appreciate your prayers.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Peter Schweizer, ladies and gentlemen, it's called Extortion. It's available on Amazon and wherever books are sold.
So the frustration people are feeling with their politicians is well placed.
You wouldn't think that they would hijack an industry, but they do it. They say, look, are we got a clean air bill coming up? I want $10,000 in my campaign fund, or I will vote to curtail your activities. And you're talking about millions, billions of dollars.
What happened to the politician who goes to Washington to serve?
That was only Jimmy Stewart in the movies, Mr. Smith.
Hello, Hollywood.